Bristol Community College, Mathematics with Dan Avedikian, Math 119, Fundamental Statistics, Section 6.1, Problem 5. This is Section 6.1, Problem number 5. It says, consider the probability distribution shown below. So we have a probability distribution. Part A asks, is it a valid probability distribution? Well, like the last question, yes, of course it is, because if it wasn't, then you couldn't answer parts B, C, D, or E. But why is it valid? Let's talk about that. Well, to be a valid probability distribution, you have to satisfy three requirements. The first requirement being that every value in the first column is a number, as opposed to a color or a letter or something. So that's good. Everything in the first column is a number. The second requirement is that everything in the second column is a value between 0 and 1, which is also the case. That's good. And the third requirement is that the total of the second column is 1. So if you add 0.25 plus 0.10 is 0.35, and then 0.35 plus 0.65 is 1, or 1.0. Again, I think of this as money. 25 cents and 10 cents is 35 cents. 35 cents and 65 cents is a dollar. As soon as it's money, it's much easier to do. So the answer to part A is yes, and it's yes because it satisfies the three requirements for a probability distribution. B, draw the histogram. So in other words, the bar graph that would go with this probability distribution. So the bars have to be vertical. They have to touch for it to be a histogram. So let's see if I can fit it right below. So my biggest probability is 0.65. Most of these I run in chunks of 5% until I go up high enough. So this is going to be 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50, 55, 60, 65. So let's label it up. 0.05, 0.10, 0.15, 0.20, 0.25, 0.30, 0.35, 0.40, 0.45, 0.50, 0.55, 0.60, and finally 0.65. And that's big enough to accommodate my biggest probability. That's going to indicate the heights of the bars. So the first bar has a probability of 0.25. It will have a height of 0.25. On my number scale, 0.25 is right there. I'll draw a bar, a vertical bar. Right under the bar, I'll put the value from the first column, which is 10. Now the next bar will go up to a height of 0.10, which is that height. Again, the bars will be vertical, they'll touch. The number under the center of that second bar will be 20. That's the value from the first column. And the last bar is very tall. It goes up to 0.65, which is here. So make sure the bars touch. I'll take it up to a height of 0.65. Try and keep the bars the same width. And the number under the last bar is the number from the first column, which is 30. So there's the histogram. Now, C, find the mean. So the mean is the average value, like if you conducted this experiment many, many times. And the way to find that mean is multiply every number in the first column times its probability, get the results, and add them together. So in the top row, the number in the first column is 10 times its probability of 0.25. And if you multiply 10 times 0.25, the answer is 2.5. And then the middle row, the number in the first column is 20 times this probability is 0.10. 20 times 0.10 is 2. 2.0 if you like, or just 2. And in the bottom, you're going to have the number from the first column is 30 times this probability is 0.65. And if you multiply 30 times 0.65, it's 19.5. So now that you've done every number in the first column times probability, take the answers that you've gotten and add them together. So 2.5 plus 2 is 4.5. 4.5 plus 19.5 is 24. So that's the mean. The mean is 24. And as a rule of thumb, the histogram, if you cut it out of wood, should balance right over what that mean is. So the midway point between 20 and 30 is 25, 24. It looks about right. And you don't have to do that. That's just an extra bit of information. The variance now is going to come from filling out a chart. And the variance is a measure of how spread out the results of your experiment are from one trial to the next. So my chart will have a column for x, a column for x minus the mean, the symbol for that is mu, then x minus the mean in parentheses raised to the second power, and then finally x minus the mean in parentheses to the second power times probability of x, and the probability of x will be these values that are given in the original question. So the x values are the easiest column to fill in, 10, 20, 30. So you go over to the x column, 10, 20, 30. There they are. Now, the next column, x minus mu. So from every value of x, you'll subtract off the value of mu, the mean, which was 24. So on the top row, x minus mu is 10 minus 24, which is negative 14. And then in the middle row, x minus mu, x is 20 minus mu is 24, that is negative 4. And then in the bottom, x minus mu is 30 minus 24, which is positive 6. So now the next column over, what you're going to do is raise those values to the second power. So x minus mu in the top row is negative 14. So the next column, you'll do negative 14 second power. Negative 14 times negative 14 is positive 196. Then the next row down, the middle row, the previous column, the x minus mu gave me a result of negative 4. So I'm going to do negative 4 second power. Negative 4 times negative 4 is positive 16. Again, the negatives cancel when you do second power. And in the bottom row, the x minus mu result was 6. So in this column, I'm going to do 6 second power. 6 times 6 is 36. And for the last column, what I will do is take those answers for x minus mu second power and multiply them all times probability of x, which I'll pick up from the original question. So in the top row, the x minus mu second power is 196. And I'm going to multiply that times the probability for x, 0.25. So if I do 196 times 0.25, that comes out to 49. Which you can do on a calculator. I'm just dividing 196 by 4. It's the same as 196 times a quarter. However you do it, it's 49. So now middle row, the x minus mu second power was 16. And I'll multiply that times probability of x from the middle row. It's 0.10. So 16 times 0.10 is 1.6. And finally, in the bottom row, the x minus mu second power result was 36. So I'll multiply that 36 times the probability of x for my bottom row. My probability of x here is 0.65. And that one I might have to do on a calculator. So let's see, 36 times 0.65 is 23.4. So now I have the whole chart filled out. What I need to do to finish off the question, what's the variance, is I have to add 49 plus 1.6 plus 23.4. Now 23.4 is still on the screen of the calculator, so I'll just add 1.6 plus the top value is 49. Gives me a total of 74. I get a total of all the values in that last column, 74. So that's the variance. The variance is 74. And finally, the last part, the standard deviation. Standard deviation will be the square root of whatever the variance was. Square root of 74. I'll let the calculator do that for me. Let's see. 8.6023, and it goes on to the end of the screen. A little more than 8.6 is the standard deviation.